our Father who art in heaven. This morning we salute before thy throne of mercy, thanking you, dear Lord, for your constant love upon us. Heavenly Father, you know what is going on right now here at Chelston Church. We have lost a gallant soldier. This gap, dear Lord, is only you, through your infinite wisdom, that you can fill it up to the church and to the family. We commit the family, we commit all the mourners into your hands.
The procession will go as follows. After I sit down, I'll invite Sister Smalwan in to give us a church history of the late. After which, I invite the family member to come and give us the family history. After the family history, the tribute that was given to the church for one of the in-laws.
I invite you to the church history of Sister Christina Lungu, known as Amai Lungu. Amai Lungu was baptized in 1996 through a crusade. She was baptized right behind in this church, and there's a baptism for there. She identified herself with this group, Dorcas, in 1998. From there, Sister Lungu identified herself as a prayer warrior. She has been in the prayer band from 1998 to this day. Sister Lungu served as a deaconess in this church. The church here, the prayer band reports at church at 7 hours every Saturday. You will never beat Sister Lungu on time. She was always here. Sister Lungu never missed any rally, Dorcas rally, since she was baptized. She never missed any camp meeting since she was baptized. She was a pillar. She was a counselor. She was a prayer warrior. I want to appeal to the family. If you want to meet this lady, children and grandchildren who you stayed with your grandmother, follow her footsteps. She is heaven bound. That day when the trumpet will sound, we are sure Sister Lungu is going to meet Jesus. Incline yourself to God. If it was not this COVID, this corona, this church grounds was going to be full with people who come and mourn this lady because of her heart. This lady, it was not this COVID, she was going to have a guard of honor by our brass band, the Pathfinders. This is a grand soldier. Rich in spirit she was. I invite the family, each one, to see this lady for her footsteps. I remember when my dad died here in Osaka. Me, I'm from Namola. She's the only Dorcas worker who stepped a foot at my father's funeral in Namola. This one. This woman was strong in faith. Follow her footsteps. God bless you.
Now, the brief history. Brief history for Mama Christina Angripina Lungu. Mama Angripina Lungu was born in 1940 at Mtowe village, Chifimpezeni, in Chipata. She got married in 1957 to Mr. Alfeo Gassiano Lungu. Amai Angripina is survived by 4 children, 15 grandchildren, and 20 great-grandchildren. She passed on Monday morning at home at the age of 79. May she rest in peace.
Amen. I paid respect in the Zambian way, and I felt so honored. Even though there was a language barrier, I had no doubt that Mom loved me. She told me that I was her son, and I had no choice in it. That was it. I loved Mom the moment we met. We bonded the moment we met. Because of the love she had from God, it was genuine and infectious. Mom came to Colorado in the United States and stayed with Anne and I. I had an instant feeling of family when I could come home from work. Mom always made sure that I was okay and I never ate so well. Mom could really cook. Mom filled a spot in my heart that had been empty for almost my whole life. I was loved and accepted son. When we would go on a day trip and see the sights that Colorado offered, Mom would always react in some way. In closing, I would like to say that Mom helped me more fulfill, realize the importance of my relationship with God. It was to be the most important relationship I have. Mom's love for her family was undeniable. Mom's passing hits me very hard. I will never forget Mom. She will live on. In my heart, I find comfort in the fact that Mom knew Jesus and that one day I will see her again and hear that little laughter again. I'm sure that she will have a lot to say on that day we all meet in the presence of Jesus on that day. When he calls us all to be with him. In loving memory, always Mark.
Tata Maya wendo meno bewine wenkashi. Busheta ule fayo kusambwako. Uko mandeli maiza kuyoda nikulia. Tuka nasekele la yoda.
Church, I had an occasion to simply interact with the surviving four children to our late mother, Sister Christina Lungu. And the question that I wanted to find out from them is if they could share with us some of their fondest memories with their mother. Some responses were rather quite catchy. Deacon Moses Lungu, who apparently is the last born to the late, who is also our member here and the serving deacon, remembers his mother as a friend. Not from a superficial point of view, but for the fact that he was the last born, and you know, usually the relationship that exists between a parent and the last child. A week would hardly go by without her checking on him. In fact, in his own words, 2 or 3 days, if she doesn't call, then she would come at home to come and check on him. Sister Annie Lungu, who's based in the US, fondest memory of her mother emanates from the year 2016 when Sister Christina would fly to go and attend the graduation of her daughter. And she would be in the US for, I believe, 18 months, where they would share memories that now only remain, you know, a mere memory. Honest in the US, Sister Lungu, because of her extroverted personality, it was easy for her to be noticeable. She would be called a saint at the church that she was congregating from, Kenanai Seventh-day Adventist Church. Brother Charles and Brother Peter share similar sentiments. What seems to come out vividly is that you have heard from the life history that she was 79, and apparently she was turning 80 towards the fall of this month. She lost her husband when she was only 43. So the children we are referring to, regardless of not being in formal employment, she fought for their plight and saw to it that they were all educated. I don't know if she used to do this to every pastor who comes here, but I knew every time I stood to preach, after the service, she would come and give me feedback. She would come to say a word or two about the message. I remember one confrontation I had with her in a positive sense. We had just announced that this church will now go solo. We would not be having an interpreter. When she protested, she launched a one-man protest, you know, lobbying that interpretation should not be taken away. We have indeed lost one among us. Her warmth and her personality will be missed even by the church family. This morning, I invite your attention to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 34, reading verse 1. I read from the New King James Version. And Moses went up from the plains of Moab to the mountain of Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, that is against Jericho, and the Lord showed him all the land of Gilead and to Dan. Verse 4 to 6. And the Lord said unto him, This is the land which I saw unto your fathers Abraham, unto Isaac, unto Jacob, saying, I will give it to thy seed. And I have caused thee to see it with thine hand, thine eyes, but thou shalt not go there. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, over against Bethpor, but no man knows his tomb unto this day. God bless the reading of his word. Amen. One of the most fascinating and dramatic way of dying is the death of Moses. Dramatic in the sense that God seems to be a drama king in this particular episode. God calls Moses to the top of the mountain, Pisgah. And he begins to do strange things. I mean, I don't know if you have seen God do strange things. This is one of the strangest things God does. He calls Moses, come to the mountaintop. And Moses goes to the mountain. And I can imagine, every step upward is panting with jubilation and excitement, knowing he's going to meet God. He is excited. He is contented. He has this euphoria about meeting his creator in a cloud. But when he reaches there, God begins to do some drama. Brings Moses over here. Can you cast your eye? Like Pisgah was the longest in this mountain range. So the tip of the mountain on the summit, Moses, can you cast your eye as far as your eye can see? And Moses can imagine him opening up his eyes to look around the beautiful valley and the veil of this particular mountain range. And then God says, you're not done, come this way. He takes him to the other side of the mountain, and Moses is simply admiring the fair land, and he was even able to see beyond the river Jordan. This is the promised land, the land that many had died in faith to inherit, the land that flows with milk and honey, the land that they had wandered in the wilderness 40 years, you know, looking forward to occupy this prestigious heritage that God had sown to his people. And so Moses is excited, finally, the long and weary journey is coming to an end. God's people are about to enter the promised land. Then comes a sad announcement. The announcement is, but you are not going to inherit the land. You actually are going to die here and now. The assembly that you have led all these 40 years will occupy the land. But you have been forbidden from inheriting the land. You are dying here and you are dying now. And God does something strange. Go down to the mountain, meet the assembly, and announce your own death. Tell them to go ahead, but without you. Tell them that you are going to die here and that you will be buried in this very mountain. The mountain that was sweet to climb became bitter to descend. Every step downward to come and announce his death was heavy. It was with a heavy heart and with heavy steps. When finally he comes to announce that God has told me I am going to die here. Very dramatic indeed. But it poses a question. Why is God doing such a strange thing? Maybe we need to begin by answering the question, why should Moses die before inheriting the promise? Why should Moses be punished, especially at such a time as this? I will submit to you four reasons. Reason number one is because Moses had sinned. I will quickly remind you of the sin of Moses. In the book of Numbers, chapter 20, verse 7, going downwards, there's a story of speaking to the rock, and the rock will give you water. You remember there was no water in the wilderness? So God tells Moses, go and speak to the rock before the assembly, and then the rock will give you water. But because these people had complained, and they were in the habit of abusing their leader, Moses was so furious. He assembled the whole assembly together as per instruction. And when they all gathered, young and old, men and women, Moses lifted up his rod, filled with rage and anger, bursting in temper. Moses announced, now listen to me, you rebels. Should I bring out water out of this rock? And then he smote the rock twice, but water still came out anyway. It seems like it was a small matter that Moses had publicly disregarded the will of God. Many, many years had passed. Moses was now an old man. Even when he was being called to the mountain, he had forgotten what he had done. But that sin still stood in his way. And God was going to punish him for the sin, the unconfessed sin that he had done many, many years ago. I will remind you, dear children of God, that to inherit the heavenly Canaan, the heavenly promised land of God, going to heaven, one sin is enough to bar you away from inheriting the kingdom of God. That is why every sin must be confessed and every sin must be forgiven. You are not going to enter the promised land because of that one sin. That one unconfessed sin you had committed many, many years ago, and now his own sin catches up with him. That's reason number one. Reason number two, the reason God is making Moses not to enter the promised land in such a dramatic manner is that that one sin he had done many years ago was a public sin. A public sin needs public confession and it needs public punishment. And so, you remember that when God spoke out of the cloud, telling Moses, speak to the rock and the rock will give you water, everyone heard. And when Moses instead beat the rock twice, everyone saw. So there were those who felt justified by the wrong example of the leader, who felt they also had a license in like manner to discredit discredit and disregard the law of God. Because here is a leader who has no regard about the instructions of God. And so in order for God to correct the wrong impression, God needed to publicly deal with the public sin. So that those who felt licensed in doing their own private and secret sins may learn the hard lesson that God punishes every sin. So God was going to make Moses a public example. But there is another reason why Moses had to die in this dramatic way. Reason number three: as a rebuke to those who abused him. Sometimes we have learned not to appreciate each other. And the people that we are vehemently mistreating, vehemently abusing, and criticizing, and gossiping about, the best God can do is to allow them to rest so that maybe you will realize the value that they had in your life. Isn't it in this country? When Levi Patrick Mwanawasa died, all of a sudden he became a saint, he became a hero. When Mwanawasa rose to presidents, you called him what? Cabbage. Today, you politicians are even using, especially those in the opposition, you're even using the legacy of Mwanawasa as the prime and the time that Zambia was at its best in order to hit back at the government of the day. But all of a sudden, when he's dead, that's when his good works come to view. That's when we realize, oh, so he was a good man. So he was a hardworking president. So he was a man of integrity. But he's gone. Sometimes God takes away the people that we least appreciate in our lives, allows them to die, so that we can realize that indeed we have lost someone who was worthy in our lives. Some of you, I wouldn't be wrong that you are here shedding crocodile tears. If really the hand of God could expose our intent and motives and things we have done in the past, this woman lying here, out of your mouth, you gossiped about her. You criticized her. Even the children, I wouldn't be wrong. With all the beautiful tributes that are being given here, I will not be wrong that at one point or the other, you may have stood to her face. You may have abhorred her discipline. She's gone. Then now we realize, oh, what a virtuous woman we had. 40 years of abuse. Anything that goes wrong, they would point a finger at Moses. The Bible describes Moses as the meekest man, the most humble person who has ever trod this earth before. But even the most humble person, they succeeded to upset the humble person. He lost his cool. When he sinned, it's because they caused him to sin. And now God is allowing Moses to die when they needed him the most as a way of rebuking them. Beloved of God, we are sponsoring the death of many people because of our careless talk and our irresponsible attitude. There are many good people that die brokenhearted. Many good people whose life has been made twice hard because we don't regard them, because we're careless. God's people, those who have sacrificed their comfort to the service of the Lord, you repay them by undue criticism. They must die, and let's see how you survive. Your parent who wakes up in the middle of the night, shedding tears for you before God, the best you can do is to stand to their face, sometimes even ask them, why did you bear me? And when they are gone and resting, you want to cry the loudest. God is rebuking you. Learn the lesson to appreciate people while they are alive. Amen. So you have traveled the whole way to come and mourn, isn't it? So how caring were you when she was alive? Did you even mind how you spoke to her or encouraged her? We are ready to spend when someone is dead, give an honorary funeral, willing to dip in our pockets and purses to contribute that the funeral can be honorable. Don't scatter roses after I'm gone. Give them to me now. Wow, I carry on. Now I need them to help me along. Don't scatter roses after I'm gone. You're waiting to put a flower on your parents' funeral. When now they are fighting and struggling in the village, when they ask for a little something, even when you give, you are giving because you're complaining. But when she is dead, but when he is gone, when your father and mother and those closest to you are gone, you are willing to give more than is required for their funeral. When are we going to learn the lesson that we need each other to carry on? We need to lift our burdens as we journey on. We need to be more kind and more tolerant. We need to be more warm-hearted and more loving to each other. We are all interwoven in the web of humanity. What befalls one befalls all of us. Cursed are you if your responsibility is to make the lives of others twice hard. May it be your prayer every morning when you wake up to ask God, God, help me to be a blessing to those I will come in contact with today. The ways of God are not our ways, neither are our thoughts the thoughts of God. The ways of God are higher. We are mourning here and broken, and yet we have no idea that in the wisdom of God, this may be a blessing in disguise. In the book of Revelation, I heard the great voice saying, write, blessed are they that die in the Lord from now henceforth, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. Some of the deaths, the funerals that we pant about, that we struggle to find the answers to, those are blessed funerals because God looks at the destiny. God looks at the end and he does not look at the here and the now. We may mourn, we may ask questions and feel discouraged, feel alone and feel deserted. But in the wisdom of God, it is well with our souls.
Yeah. Christina Lungu, back to the ground, dust to dust, earth to earth. I now invite all those that want to be witnesses and want to participate to come wherever they are. Please come and grab some piece of soil and then throw in the grave.
Ambia Mungu watu nipe mhamunano ambuye Christina ambuye mkone seni mwa mtendere manda mwamene wagona ambuye mzimu wange uuse mwa mtendere ambuye ana ina walawanisi ambuye kuma ambuye Mungu watu nipe mhakwajina ambuye kuti mkone sebu ina mwa mtendere kone uuse mwa mtendere ambuye Mungu watu zata ambuye nitula muli ina ambuye ntula zote mzina mwana sumpurumusi watu. Amen.
Also invite all friends and family members or relatives, neighbors or any other that have not mentioned wonse bamene sina kambe apa banepa.
Christina Lungu, and we're at the burial site of my late grandma, Christina Agrippina Lungu. And today, the 2nd of August, marks the day that we put her to rest. Christina Lungu she's my grandma. She was a woman of substance, a God-fearing woman, a woman of influence. My grandma was a pillar of the family. My grandma was a woman that everyone looked up to. She even welcomed the strangers that would walk in the way because she was a woman who had a heart of God. They say angels don't exist, but in my grandma, I found an angel that existed and still exists in our hearts and still remember the love, the care, that grandma showed towards us. We love you, grandma, even as you've departed upon this land of earth. We still hold you in our hearts and know that we'll always remember you. We love you. Thank you.
I'm Moses Lungu. I'm the last born son of Amai Lungu. And today we have been burying my mother on the 2nd of August 2020. Yeah, otherwise, I'm very happy that my mother died a natural death. I know by now she's in the hands of God. God is taking care of her. I've missed my mother in such that she used to be my friend, my very good friend. Whenever I haven't seen her for a day or two, she used not to feel good. She always wanted to see me all the time. We helped each other in terms of business with my mom, looking after the family, raising up family issues like looking after brothers, nieces, daughters, even grandchildren. But now, since she has left us, we have been left alone without her. My heart is not in place. Wherever you are, Mom, I really miss you. I know that your dignity, your teachings, your words have really left us in a good shape. The whole family, they are crying because we have lost someone who was a pioneer in our life. The way you used to talk to us, the way you used to teach us how to live life, we really miss you, Mom.